The history of Texas is steeped with legends and heroes. For Texans, we are brought up listening to the stories of the Texas Rangers, the Alamo, and the people who made Texas what it is today. If you grew up in Texas, you know the names of Stephen F. Austin, William Barrett Travis, and of course, Davy Crockett. These are the people that made Texas what it is today. However, those people would not have been famous without one man leading the way, Sam Houston, who would lead the Army of Texas to victory. However, Sam Houston's story is far more fascinating than just what he did in Texas. So let's turn back time and look at the story of a great Texan. Sam Houston was born on March 2, 1793, as the fifth son of Samuel and Elizabeth Paxton Houston. If Elizabeth's maiden name sounds familiar to you, then you are probably right. This makes the late actor Bill Paxton a distant relative of Sam Houston, who would go on to play Sam in the History Channel miniseries Texas Rising. As a boy, Sam Houston decided that school was not right for him, and so he only attended primary school for 6 months. Unfortunately, in 1807, tragedy would strike when Sam Houston was just 13 years old. His father died. So, wanting a fresh start, his mother moved them to East Tennessee to become farmers. While in Tennessee, he would attend a local academy. But this was not the life that Sam wanted. He wanted something more. He dreamed of something more. But when his eldest brother tried to force him to be a farmer, Sam was like any other adolescent, rebelling from authority with a dream in his mind. So, to rebel, like most children, he ran away from home. After running away from home, Houston gained a new family with a tribe of Cherokee Indians. Here, Sam would gain a new father who would teach him the ways of life. And for 3 years, Sam would reside with his adopted family. And they even gave him a new name, Kalonahe, or the Raven. Sam would find that the Cherokee were more than a family than his actual family. However, just like when he was 13 years old, he was restless, and he left his adopted family. Even though he left, this was a major turning point in Sam Houston's life, as he would gain a sympathetic view of Indians that would play a major part in his life and dealings with Native Americans in the future. Upon leaving his adopted family, he was just 18 years old, and Houston decided to open a school. Now, if you are thinking that Houston did this because he desired to educate young minds, this was not the case. He opened the school to pay off his growing debts. However, just like everything in his life, Houston was still not happy. But luck would have it, the War of 1812 would break out, and Houston would finally find his calling. So at the age of 21, in 1813, Sam would enlist in the army, and quickly rise through the ranks and win many awards during the war. His accolades even caught the attention of future President Andrew Jackson, who was serving as a general during the War of 1812, and instrumental in the Battle of New Orleans. Houston would learn a lot from Jackson, and adopt many political views from the general. In return, Jackson became Houston's friend and benefactor. After the war, Houston remained in the army, and because of his relationships with the Indians, became an Indian sub-agent and would help them relocate the Native Americans from their homelands to the Indian reservations in Oklahoma. However, this does benefit Houston, as he would be able to use his influence to relocate peacefully his adopted family to their new homeland and get them a good piece of land on the reservation. However, because of how Secretary of War John C. Calhoun would treat the other Indians, Houston resigns his commission. His resignation from the army, like most of this story, is just changing his path and putting him on the path to Texas. Free from the army, Houston moved back to his home state of Tennessee and opened a law practice. However, this still did not satisfy his restlessness, and so he joined the state militia and was appointed to the rank of colonel. It was through his work in the militia and his law practice that, while he was living in Nashville in 1818, was appointed to the position of Attorney General of Nashville. Still, this would still not satisfy Houston, and so he decided to return to private practice. And while he was in private practice, rose through the rank to become a Major General in the state militia. To tell you the truth, Sam Houston begins to sound like many college students who keep switching their major in college. What is interesting is that because of him being so well liked, and because he was part of Andrew Jackson's inner circle, this part of his life became the stepping stones for a political career that could have gone all the way to the presidency. So during this time, Houston, in 1823, became a representative of the 9th Tennessee District. He would serve the people of Tennessee until 1827 and decide to return to Tennessee to pursue the governor's office, for which he won. Here is where his life takes a turn, however. He marries a 19-year-old by the name of Eliza Allen in 1829. And again, his life starts to take a dark turn. Because after only 11 weeks of marriage, the marriage ended. She just packed up and left him, moving back in with her parents. The reason that she left remained a mystery. But that did not stop the rumor mills from going. Many people said that he beat his 19-year-old wife because he drank too much. Or that Houston cheated on her with another woman. Whatever the story of the separation, neither Eliza or Houston would talk about it. And Houston, till the day he died, never said a disparaging word about her. Even though he would not talk bad about her, the divorce destroyed him, to the point where he resigned the governorship and retreated to a place he knew, going back to his adopted family. This ultimately ended any chance of him becoming president of the United States. However, it put him on the path to Texas. Back with his adopted family, he tried to find tranquility and thus rejected white society. This is kind of like what most teenagers would do during a bad breakup, locking themselves in their room. He was just doing this as an adult. However, he did not throw off all of white society, as he would have contact with one other person, Andrew Jackson. Like some divorcees, he turned to the bottle and began to drink. A lot. So much so that he earned the nickname from his adoptive family called Big Drunk. Even though he hit rock bottom, there was still a silver lining. He was officially granted citizenship of the Cherokee Nation, and thus could take a second wife, and thus married Diana Rogers Gentry. By the way, he was also not officially divorced from Eliza, so he had two wives. However, no one seemed to care, but life on the reservation was good, but he was still restless, as he decided to enter white society again. So he left his wife Diana and moved to Mexican, Texas on December 2nd, 1832. Houston came to Texas and immediately saw it as a land of promise. However, being the man he was, he quickly became embroiled in the rebellion against Mexico. By the time of 1835, he believed that war was inevitable, and so he became a very outspoken supporter for Texas for Texans, which included Indians and Tejanos in his mind. And so he began to participate in committees pertaining to independence. So much so that in November of 1835, Sam Houston was given a commission of Major General of the Texas Army. Now, this was more of an informal commission to allow Sam to negotiate with Native American tribes to get them to help in a war against Mexico. However, Houston did not have to wait long for a Declaration of Independence for Texas to be formed on March 2nd of 1836, thus officially giving him control of the Army of Texas. And so, he ordered, as general, William Barrett Travis and Jim Bowie to the Alamo, so that they could hold off Santa Anna's troops when they crossed the border. Houston's plan was to ensure he had enough time to train a bunch of militias to be an Army of Texas. Kind of like what George Washington had to go through when he was training American soldiers to fight the British. This action, of course, sealed the fate of the men in the Alamo, which is another great story of the great state of Texas. And for 13 days, the men of the Alamo kept Santa Anna's attention while Sam Houston strategically retreated to train his army. The problem that he faced was a political structure within his army, where the commanders of his army thought he was a coward for not helping the boys at the Alamo. His commander labeling him a coward began to affect the troops, as many of his own soldiers began to believe that Sam Houston was a coward. When word finally reached his encampment of what happened at the Alamo, William Barrett Travis's victory or death letter, the letter and the brutal way the troops of the Alamo died, rallied his men together. His troops thought he would attack, but they were not ready, and he was looking for a perfect place to have a battle. Retreating toward the border of the U.S. and Texas, many thought Houston was going to get the aid from the U.S. government. However, Houston did this to lure Santa Anna into thinking he was trying to get U.S. aid, and that he feared Santa Anna. But Houston knew that for anyone to take Texas seriously as an independent nation, they had to win this battle themselves. So he kept retreating till he finally found the perfect land to have the battle, San Jacinto. This land was perfect for one reason, where the Mexican army was going to camp. They would be blocked on three sides if he were to cut the bridges off from two rivers on either side of them, and behind them was marshy land. Of course, the Texas Army was also cut off from retreating, so whoever was going to win, it was going to be bloody. So during the battle, Sam Houston planned to have the bridges destroyed. Another leverage that Sam Houston used in the confrontation was Santa Anna's overconfidence. At dawn, Santa Anna was ready to fight, but Houston did not attack. And so by noon, Santa Anna thought Houston was a coward, and so he didn't have him attack, and he called out to him. And so he ordered his men to stand down and return to their tents. This was Santa Anna's mistake. At 4 p.m., Houston launched his attack, catching the Mexican army by surprise. During the battle, he was shot in the ankle, but continued to fight. By the end of the battle, or at least close to the end of the battle, Santa Anna retreated, leaving his men to die, and ran away. However, Houston would eventually capture him. After Santa Anna either traded his clothes for a woman's dress or traded his clothing for a lower-ranking officer, no one knows for sure what happened, but his men did spot him and called him out. They snitched him. They snitched on him. Ratted him out. Houston gave Santa Anna two choices. Houston could kill him now, or Santa Anna would recognize Texas independence. Of course, Santa Anna, wanting to keep his life, took the second offer. Thus, Texas became an independent nation and eventually a state in the Union. After the Texas Revolution, Houston would become the first president of the Independent Republic of Texas. And eventually, once Texas becomes a state in the Union, he will become the first governor of the state of Texas. All through his life, events prepared him to lead Texas into a bright future. Houston is one of those people that has been remembered in film by people like Richard Boone, Dennis Quaid, and of course, the late Bill Paxton. We have remembered Houston in the state of Texas by several things. One of which is a giant monument in Huntsville, Texas, and of course, a city in Texas bears his name. However, his story tells us that no matter where life takes you, events prepare you for who you're supposed to be, and so no matter what happens, never give up.
Take me to Texas. 200 years ago, where a pride rose from the ashes of San Jacinto, still beats in every heart like a battle cry. Where I was born, where I was raised, so when I die, take me to Texas on the open range. The Rio Grande is in my veins, it's heaven there. And so my prayer is that you'll take me anywhere in Texas, the only home I know. I'm a child of the Alamo and the yellow rose. So when I go, take me to Texas, where my daddy worked, where his blood and sweat and tears are still in that red dirt. While Palominos run, cowboys are kings, And if I stray too far, I'll let my Lone Star dreams take me to Texas on the open range. The Rio Grande is in my veins. It's heaven there, and so my prayer is that you'll take me there.